Welcome to the final leg of the journey through the Beethoven String Quartets. We're going to begin with the penultimate quartet that he composed, Opus 131 in C-sharp minor. He completed this quartet in May of 1826, which is just about 10 months before the end of his life in March of 1827. When he was done with this quartet and the final quartet in F major, his friend Carl Holtz, whom we have met before, he played second violin in the Schuppanzig Quartet, he asked Beethoven, which of your quartets is your favorite quartet? And Beethoven was a little bit evasive at first. He said, each in its own way, art demands of us that we not stand still. And of course, this response contains the essence of his artistic credo. He never did stand still. He always was moving forth, going off into unknown territory. But he thought about it some more, and then he came back, and he admitted that in many ways, this one, the C-sharp minor quartet, was his favorite. Although he couched it in rather oblique terms, he said, in this quartet, you will find a new manner of voice treatment, and thank God, there is less lack of fantasy than ever before. Which is a peculiar way of putting it. It's like there's less lack of understatement in putting it that way, because this piece was considered so avant-garde when it was composed that it was not performed publicly until 1835, a full 9 years after it was composed. As to why it was Beethoven's favorite quartet, we can only speculate, but I have a sense that it's a quartet which combines enormous diversity with enormous sense of integration in the end. And in many ways, it is unprecedented in its form. It ranges over a huge number of different styles and characters and forms. It's about 35 minutes in its totality. It doesn't stop in between the movements. It goes from one right into the next. It begins in C-sharp minor in this rather world-weary fugue. It goes on for about 6 or 7 minutes. And it doesn't really end. It kind of melts away to a fermata. And then suddenly we find ourselves in the second movement, which is in D major, a much brighter and more earthly and joyful realm, and that is a rondo form movement. And from there, it goes into B minor for a third movement, which is less of a movement and more of a transition. It is a wordless recitative, which takes us into the central pillar of this arch. It really is the keystone of this arch. It is 13-minute A major theme and variations movement. After that, into E major for a very upbeat scherzo and trio. After that, into G-sharp minor, a very dark key, where he writes what seems like a wordless opera aria, but it doesn't really last very long. And finally, we return, complete this journey, back into the tonality of C-sharp minor for a movement which is in Allegro, sonata Allegro form. And so this large piece has these main pillars. The first movement is a fugue, the fourth movement is theme and variations, the last movement is sonata Allegro, and these were the forms that I think were most important to him at the end of his life. And also, it is this great sense of tying it all together in a neat bow at the end that I think must have appealed to him. It certainly appealed to many of his most visionary followers. For instance, Schubert, in his last weeks on earth, this was November of the following year of 1828, he was on his deathbed, and he asked Carl Holtz, would you bring a string quartet here to play Opus 131 for me? I would like to hear it. And they did, and Carl Holtz described his response. Schubert fell into such a state of excitement and enthusiasm that we were all frightened for him. Schubert's comment at the completion of the performance was, after this, what is there left for us to write? A few years later, Robert Schumann fell in love with this piece. He was also fascinated by the first of the late quartets, the E-flat major quartet, Opus 127, and he wrote, "They have a grandeur which no words can express. They seem to me to stand on the extreme boundary of all that has hitherto been attained by human art and imagination." And perhaps the great composer who was most impressed by this piece was Richard Wagner. In 1854, in Zurich, he organized a concert in which this was the featured piece, and he actually coached the string quartet because he wanted to hear it played a particular way. And some years later, in 1870, in honor of the centennial year of Beethoven's birth, he wrote an essay about this piece, which is very flowery and poetic, and he describes the piece in these terms. "If we wish to form a picture of a day in the life of our sacred genius, Beethoven, we can do no better than to derive it from one of his own marvelous compositions. To illustrate such a typical day in Beethoven's inner life, I will choose the C-sharp minor quartet." This piece begins with a fugue. It's a very different kind of a fugue than the fugue that we saw at the end of the B-flat major quartet. It is world-weary. It has this aura of infinite sadness to it. And I think that by beginning with a fugue and by having written his Grosse Fuge in the previous quartet, in a way he is coming full circle relative to his feelings about counterpoint and Bach in general. If you were at the first of these conversations in which we talked about the first three Opus 18 quartets, I gave a little bit of background information about Beethoven when he was growing up in Bonn as a teenager. And I think I mentioned that he had fallen in love with the well-tempered clavier of Bach. He had studied it as a pianist, but also as a budding composer, and had committed much of it to memory. When he came to live permanently in Vienna in 1792 at the age of 22, he went ostensibly to study with Haydn. That didn't work out so well, so he moved on to a lesser composer, but perhaps a better pedagogue, a gentleman named Johann Georg Albrecht Berger. And Albrecht Berger's approach to teaching composition was through the avenue of learning to control counterpoint. He felt that that was the way that you learned. And so Beethoven's early quartets, in the development sections particularly, have a great deal of counterpoint. And as we move through all of these quartets, when we get into the middle quartets, counterpoint, fugal textures become more and more important. For instance, in the third of the Razumovsky quartets, the last movement, C major, has this blistering fugato at the beginning of it. And as we have seen in the last quartets, the Grosse Fuge, and now this, I think that for Beethoven in his last days, fugue had become this nexus in his mind between spirit and technique and everything that went into composition. To introduce this piece a little bit further, I will read you what Wagner himself wrote about this first movement. He said, "The long opening adagio, surely the saddest utterance ever made in notes, I should call the awakening of the day on which, to quote Goethe's Faust, in the whole long course, it shall not fulfill a single wish, not one. It is at the same time a penitential prayer, a communion with God out of a firm belief in the eternal good."
Thank you.
as you hear, it has this aura of infinite sadness. And if we look at the subject on which this fugue is built, we see that it really consists of two contrasting elements. There is what we'll call the head motive, which has this rising, pleading quality, and then it descends down onto this devastating groan. And then this tail motive, the other component, moves twice as quickly, and it really feels like what Wagner outlined, these praying penitents moving perhaps a little bit more consolingly forward. And in this fugal movement, he combines the full subject itself with these two components, and he treats them much as Bach treated the subject for the Art of Fugue. This was a compendium of fugues and canons that apparently Beethoven admired a great deal. And so he does similar things to what Bach does with his own subject. He will give it to us in the regular version. He will speed it up so that it is twice as fast. He will slow it down so that it is twice as slow. Sometimes he will layer it with itself in canons and various kinds of stretti. I've chosen a passage in E major from the middle of this fugue in which all of this happens, and I've just written it into the part and in subtitles so you can look at it as it goes by and hear how he treats it. Through this world-weary fugue, and we finally come to an enormous climax with this head motive again, way up in the highest range of the first violin. And once this has happened, you'll see it just melts away. It comes down to, passes through C major, and finally it just melts, and we have just a single octave at the end, rather ambiguous harmony. So the piece doesn't seem to end, it just rests there for a second. And from this C-sharp point of arrival, it becomes a point of departure, and immediately we launch up a half step into D major for this rondo movement, and it's quite different in its character. It is jig-like, it is joyful. And being a rondo, we know that this theme that we've just listened to is going to come back at regular intervals over the course of this movement, interspersed with what we expect to be contrasting material. In fact, the non-rondo material is cut from the same cloth as the rondo itself. And so this movement has a kind of textural homogeneity, just like the C-sharp minor fugue had a textural homogeneity. And this is how these movements work. They contrast greatly with each other, sometimes not so much within the confines of the movements themselves. And as with the original movement, the first movement, he rises to a big climax, and then again it melts away. And it leaves us not on an octave, but on an interval with only two notes, a D and an F sharp, the two lower components of a D major triad. And then immediately we go into the next movement, which is a wordless recitative. And he manifests this modulation through the simplest mean possible. He takes this D and F sharp, which were the bottom of a D major triad, and he adds a B natural to the bottom, which means now we're in a B minor triad. And this music, again, we've seen this before, it's like he's breaking down these distinctions between what is vocal music, what is instrumental music, and it serves as a transition into the next movement. And we know that recitatives always introduce a song or an aria. And we go into the fourth movement and we hear the theme upon which he is going to construct six variations. And it is a very, very simple theme indeed. It feels almost like folk music, 8-bar phrases, A-A-B-A, I believe is the form of the theme. Couldn't be simpler. Wagner himself describes it as the blessed embodiment of native innocence. And yet, as you see the theme go by, you'll notice a few things about it. There's no downbeat, there's a rest. And then we have down in the cello, pizzicati, like heartbeats driving the thing forward. And in the first violin and the second violin, you'll see that he has stitched the melody together, going from first to second to first to second. It's so seamless that you'll see it go by. But if I hadn't done that, I think you might not even notice that it's two instruments playing the melody. And as we move through the theme, when we get to the repeat of this theme, he makes it more explicit what he's doing, and so this heartbeat becomes not one pizzicato note, but a double stop. And he drops the second violin an octave, so now we can hear clearly that this is two violins playing this theme, not one. And then we move into the variations on this theme. And these are a very unusual kind of variations movement, because if you think back about some of the earlier variations, for instance, in the harp quartet, Opus 74, he ends that one with a similarly simple theme. And then each of the six variations upon that theme are, one is loud, one is soft, one is loud, one is soft. He lines them up like hedges in a formal classical garden. And once he establishes the sound of a particular variation, he maintains that from beginning to end. These are very different because they develop organically within each of the variations. For instance, the first one begins with the lower components of the quartet, and they play what sounds like a bit of the theme. And then the first violin, moving twice as fast, comes down to meet them with a chromatic line in 16th notes. But rather than staying in this opening texture, it evolves, it becomes more intricate, the rhythm becomes more laced with dotted rhythms, it becomes more intense. We hear the first violin go up to the highest register and stay there, so it almost reaches a kind of a climax. it's a substantial movement. It's 13 minutes long. And so he even provides what to me seem like moments of comic relief, like at the beginning of the fourth variation. It begins with this lilting waltz, and then he begins to interject pizzicati, which have a decidedly goofy kind of quality to them. And, you know, Wagner described, again, very evocatively, the effect of these variations. He said, Beethoven finds unending rapture in ceaseless, unheard of transformations under prismatic lights, which his immortal genius casts upon it. And I have a sense that he must have been referring, with this use of that phrase, prismatic lights, to the fifth of the variations, which has this almost spooky quality. It abandons melody. It's all harmony and just shifting textures. It sounds almost like Beethovenian Gesualdo to me. Perhaps the spiritual high point of this movement, and maybe the whole piece, is the sixth variation. It begins with a long set of throbbing chords in the lower components of the quartet, and they continue like this, no melody at all. And then after a while, the first violin peels away and emerges in this rather ecstatic, prayerful melody, and then it comes down and it gathers up the second violinist, and they come down in thirds in this very chorale-like, beautiful, meditational melody. From this spiritual high point, things begin to get strange. The cellist begins to act like some small child that wants to pull at the trouser legs of the other members of the quartet for attention. As you hear, they try to ignore him, but like small children, he will not be ignored, and he becomes more persistent. Finally, the first violinist, like parents everywhere, gets annoyed and seems to say, if you don't stop that, I'm going to stop the quartet and slap you. But the damage is done, and the variation changes in its style and its character quite radically after that, and it sort of dissolves, and we go through a lot of different keys, and it ends in a completely different mood than it began. And then this disruptive cellist takes us into the next movement, this E major scherzo, with what sounds like a rather flatulent report. And this unleashes craziness. It's like everybody, it seems to me like schoolyard pranks at this point. You have this image of children running around and pulling each other's hair and shoving each other down onto the ground and giggling at each other. Feels like children's pranks, children's games. And then the trio seems like a school class trip to the countryside. We've got this bucolic bagpipe music over very rapidly interlocking components in the viola and the cello. So they call this hakadim, which means it's like a musical zipper. These parts fit together exactly. And then we go back and forth between the first section and the second section, and it begins to feel like children telling the same silly joke over and over again. And then we reach this point where it just disintegrates. They're going along and then they seem to lose their place. The music just stops, and then they try to start up again and they stop again. And then the viola and the cello seem to decide they're going to be these stern parents and they're going to issue an order to everybody to get it together. And of course, this has the usual effect, which is that things get worse. And we hear very peculiar sonic effects. You hear what sound to me like Bartokian pizzicati. And then he goes way up onto the bridge for this extended ponticello effect. It must be the first time that anybody really used this in an extended way. It creates this wiry nasal quality. But then, we've cadenced in E major and suddenly, bam, we are in G sharp minor, in fact. And this is this wordless aria, which Wagner describes as a short but gloomy spell of brooding, as if the master were sunk in the lowest depths of his dream. Such dark and contemplative music, and we think perhaps this might go on for 10 minutes, but it doesn't. It stops rather quickly, and suddenly we find ourselves in the last movement, C sharp minor again, and Wagner, this is his last description, describes this movement as the fury of the world's dance, fierce pleasure, agony, ecstasy of love, anger, passion, suffering, lightning flashes, and thunder rolls. And it begins with this swipe of Beethoven's massive bear claw. Now, if you recall from the previous conversation, he was writing all of these pieces at breakneck speed, and there are overlapping elements. And one of the elements that we hear throughout the three previous quartets, the Gallitzin quartets, are rising half steps and falling half steps as a motivic component. Here we see them, sol, la, do, si, sol, la, si, do. So there is a sense that we are beginning to come full circle here. And then he gives us the first theme itself, which is bold and fierce and really feels like the four horsemen of the apocalypse galloping at breakneck speed across the musical landscape. And then a much more exotic and deeply lamenting theme. And at some subliminal level, I think we begin to realize that we've heard this before. It seems like we are coming back to the beginning. I'll play you this lamenting theme again, and you can look at it. And I will play you the opening fugue theme from 35 minutes ago. And although it is much slower, you can see by looking at them side by side that they are essentially mirror images of each other. And we hear this la la da, that head motive coming back now more and more explicitly. And finally, he just outlines it with everybody playing it in unison three times. And again, from this sense of integration with what happened at the beginning of the piece a half an hour before, we get some sense of perhaps why for Beethoven this was his most successful string quartet and really perhaps his most successful piece. It is a great masterpiece. He gave it to his publisher early in 1827. He said, I want to dedicate it to this gentleman, Baron Joseph von Stutterheim. He said, to whom I am indebted for many kindnesses. And the kindnesses he was referring to specifically were for taking his nephew, Carl von Beethoven, into the army. And as a prelude to the final of his string quartets in F major, I will complete a story that I began to tell a few sessions ago about Beethoven's relationship with his nephew and his sister-in-law, Joanna. Beethoven in 1815 lost his brother, his name was Carl as well. And Beethoven by that time had pretty much come to terms with the fact that he was not going to get married. But he had not really come to terms with the fact that he was not going to have a family of some sort. And in the wake of the death of his brother, he decided that he would be the father of young Carl. But it was more than that. He really decided that his sister-in-law, Joanna, was not fit to bring up the boy, that she was a corrupting influence. He really thought of her as little more than a prostitute. And so he was so headstrong and hell-bent on wrenching the boy away from her that this ended up in the courts, and it raged on for 5 years. And finally, pulling every political string he could, the courts in Vienna awarded him sole custody of the boy. But of course, that wasn't the end of the story, because the mother didn't give up, wanted to be with her son. The son didn't give up, wanted to be with his mother. And every time he would slink off to be with her, Beethoven would feel more and more betrayed. And he came to a point where he was trying to secret the boy away in boarding schools and deny her access. And this got really more and more demented. And there was a point where in 1826, towards the summer, he was at the Vienna Polytechnic Institute, and Beethoven had told the man with whom Carl was boarding this. One might be led to suspect that perhaps Carl is really enjoying himself in the evening, or even at night, in some company which is certainly not so desirable. I urge you to pay attention to this and not to let Carl leave your house at night under any pretext whatsoever, unless you have received something in writing from me through Carl. And you can only imagine how the boy felt. I mean, he has this overbearing genius of an uncle he cannot possibly satisfy, and this uncle is now trying to control his comings and his goings. And at a certain point, this boy just gave up. And he went out and he pawned his watch, bought himself a couple of pistols. And he went up early in August, I think on the 5th or the 6th of August, 1826, onto the mountain at the left. These are the high Rauenstein ruins outside of Baden. And he shot himself in the head. Amazingly, he survived. He left one may have misfired. The right one, he managed to shoot himself, but it lodged in his skull, knocking him out. Didn't penetrate. A drover who was passing by roused the boy, who woke up and must have thought, how amazing to find myself alive. And he had the presence of mind to say to the drover, take me to my mother's, don't take me to my uncle's. When she saw him, she was, of course, devastated, and she had him transferred to the General Hospital in Vienna, where he spent a month healing from this wound that he had dealt himself. Beethoven was similarly devastated, and those who knew him said that he aged precipitously, went from looking like a man in his middle 50s, which he was, to looking like a man in his middle 70s, very quickly. And if you can say anything salutary about this, it is that Beethoven, I think, finally realized what a profound mistake he had been making, and he agreed to let his nephew go into the army. And so he contacted Baron von Stutterheim and arranged for him to go in. This at least would give him military discipline and older men to shape his life. But of course he had this wound and his hair hadn't grown in. And there was this terrible brouhaha going on in Vienna surrounding what had happened. And so Beethoven decided the thing to do was to take his nephew on a trip 40 miles to the west of Vienna to an area in the Danube River Valley called Gneixendorf, where his brother, Nikolaus Johann, had an estate. And this leering visage that you see here is his brother. And as you can see from looking at it, they were very different kinds of people. His brother was a pharmacist by trade, an apothecary, and apparently he made a good deal of money by dealing with the French soldiers, sold them medications at a premium, and this did not endear him to the Viennese or Austrian populace, but he was very proud of himself for having made all of this money, and he invested it into this estate at Gneixendorf, and he would write to Beethoven occasionally, and he would sign his letters, from your brother Johann, landowner. And Beethoven would respond saying, from your brother Ludwig, brain owner. Which I think tells you something about the quality of their relationship. But there were salutary aspects of being there in Gneixendorf. It gave him and young Karl some time to decompress and to try to reconcile themselves to the situation. And also, perhaps more importantly from our perspective, as I think I mentioned, this area, the Danube River Valley, was very beautiful. It reminded him of the Rhine River Valley where he had grown up outside of Bonn and where he loved to walk outside and incubate his thoughts, particularly his musical thoughts. And so while he was there, walking to the countryside outside of Gneixendorf, he was thinking about this final string quartet in the pastoral key of F major. And this string quartet is a very different sounding piece than any of the previous late quartets. It is rather good-natured. It is in four movement rather than five, six, or seven. It is conversational and even a little bit comical, just on the surface of it at least. And this leads some people to think that it's a kind of a throwback, like a Haydn-ish kind of a piece that he, in a way, could have written when he was writing his Opus 18 quartet some 25 or 30 years before. And that's a mistake, because really, in terms of its technique and its spirit and this sense of totality to it, this underlying integration, it is much, much closer to the C-sharp minor quartet that we just talked about than any of those really early quartets. And to give you a little appreciation for what I'm talking about, I'll take you for about 3 minutes under the hood of this first movement and a little of the last movement and show you some of the interrelationships. Going to the beginning of the piece, I will play it for you. Very good-natured, strolling, conversational. Now, let's leap ahead to the beginning of the last movement. And he gives us this epigraph, which he actually wrote into the score, "The resolution reached with difficulty." And he asks a musical question, "Muss es sein?" This tense interrogatory phrase that drops by a minor third and up a diminished fourth. And then he gives us an answer, "Es muss sein." And if we look at this gesture, la, do, so, so, si, fa, g, b flat, f. Now, if we go back to the very beginning of the piece, sol, la, si, fa, so, ma, it's so, si, fa, those same three notes. And if we look at the first three grace notes, sol, la, si, which we hear before the viola, and then we hear them in this little violin hiccup. And then we look ahead to the next phrase, so, do, mi, fa, la, do, fa, so, si, do, so, la, si. Now, if we jump again to the fourth movement and look at that question, so, la, it's a rising half step. If you turn it upside down, put it in the bass, re, do. And then again, if you jump ahead to the next phrase, so, fa, la, so, si, la, falling half steps. Have you had enough of this yet? I don't really mean to make this into a musical anatomy lesson. I just wanted to give you some scratching of the surface of what's going on in this piece at a under the surface level. And this is just the first 10 bars of the piece. The whole piece is put together like this. It's very much like looking at a beautiful Swiss watch. And part of the appeal of a Swiss watch is, of course, it has this surface beauty. But we know that if we pop off the top and look at this dense interrelated network of gears and weights and things that are swinging back and forth, that it has this astonishing coherence underneath the surface. Of course, we're not really meant to think about that, but it somehow gives us more appreciation for the integrity of the watch or this movement as a whole, to know that that's what's operating beneath the surface. This movement is also a little comical. Some people think of it as the string quartet Falstaff to the C-sharp minor's string quartet Otello. And the comic elements really rise to the fore in the second movement, which is a scherzo. And as we've gone through all of these quartets, over and over again, we see that Beethoven loves to play hide the downbeat with us. He loves to play metrical games, sort of making it mysterious as to where the downbeat really is. To give you a sense of that in the upcoming movement, click along with me, and I will play this for you and see if you can keep that going while you're clicking. How did you do? You can only imagine what it's like to try to play this piece. And then, as we've seen so often before, after he obliterates our sense of where the pulse is, he comes at us and he says, oh, I'm sorry, you wanted to know where the downbeat was, didn't you? Let me show you. Thank you. happens like 50 times. It's like I'll stick it in your ear. That's where the downbeat is. And from this second movement, we again change directions radically, go into the third movement, which is in the much more ecstatic key of D flat major. It's a movement that when he was sketching it out, he wrote a little title into the sketch. He called it A Sweet Song of Rest, Song of Peace. And as you'll hear, he positions the quartet in the lowest, huskiest tessitura, where it really sounds like a whispered prayer. And the melody itself is so simple, it couldn't be any simpler than it is. It starts on the home key of the home note of D flat, goes down scale-wise, a perfect fourth to an A flat, comes back up to the D flat, winds around to an F, comes back down to the D flat. To me, it sounds like the musical representation of an infinity sign. Discover then that this is a theme and variations movement for beautiful variations. And if you're looking for a place in this movement or this entire piece that in some ways seems to relate to all of the despair and disappointments of his life, I think we can look into the second variation as perhaps that moment. It goes from D flat major into the enharmonic minor of C sharp minor, which as we saw from the previous piece, is a key that he associates with world weariness. And here, this flowing, warm music suddenly freezes. It just becomes absolutely solid, and it hardly moves at all. Finally, we move into the third variation, and this frozen river begins to thaw, and it begins to move ahead again and flow. And we discover that this beautiful theme has been designed in such a way that it works in perfect canon with itself, and so you'll hear it first in the cello and then several octaves above in the first violin. This movement, we come back to this epigraph that we saw a while ago. And we ask ourselves at this point, so what does this mean? What did it mean to Beethoven? And of course, there's a lot of speculation about the meaning of this question and this answer. And before I get to that speculation, let me just play you the introduction to this last movement, in which we hear that question asked with ever greater tension and intensity 5 times. And of course, we already know what the answer is. And so what does it mean? There are all kinds of speculative answers to that question, ranging from the silly and the frivolous to the profound and the metaphysical. And I'll start with the silly and the frivolous. There was a friend of Beethoven's, or perhaps I'll call him an acquaintance, who lived in Vienna. He was a wealthy man named Ignaz Dempscher. And he was a man who loved music, and he was had adventurous tastes, and he loved to premiere new works by Beethoven in his own home. Somehow he had missed attending the premiere on March the 21st, 1826 of Opus 130, the B-flat major quartet with the Grosse Fuge. And so he decided he wanted to have a concert party and feature that piece and asked the Schuppanzig quartet to play it. And so he approached Beethoven and said, could I borrow the parts? And Beethoven said, sure, just pay me the 50 florin subscription fee that you owe me for, you know, that concert that you missed, and they're yours for the night. And Dempscher was apparently very wealthy, but very cheap. And so he invited the second violinist, Beethoven's friend, Karl Holtz, over to his home to negotiate with him. And at a certain point in their conversation, apparently Dempscher said to him, must it be? Must I pay you this subscription fee? And Holtz went back to Beethoven and he conveyed that question, and Beethoven apparently threw up his hands and grabbed a piece of music paper and wrote out a quick canon, as we've seen before that he does. And he said, give this to Dempscher, it'll answer his question. That apparently is the actual etymology of this idea, but it's not very satisfying. When he wrote to his publisher, Moritz Schlesinger, he wrote to him, he said, here, my friend, is my last quartet. It will be the last. And indeed, it has given me much trouble, for I could not bring myself to compose the last movement. But as your letters were reminding me of it, in the end, I decided to compose it. And that is the reason why I have written the motto, the difficult resolution, must it be, it must be. That's no more satisfying than the story about Dempscher. There was a writer back in the 1920s named J.W.N. Sullivan who wrote a book called Beethoven's Spiritual Development, and he offered what I think is a somewhat more satisfying conjecture. The motto is a summary of the great Beethovenian problem of destiny and submission. But Beethoven has found his solution to the problem, and he treats the old question with lightness, even with the humor of one to whom the issue is settled and familiar. The portentous question meets with a jovial, almost exultant answer. It would appear that at the end of his life, the inner Beethoven, who expressed himself in music, was content. So if we look again at this "it must be" gesture, la do so, so C, fa, G, B flat, F, we see these descending fourths. And if we look at the canonic gesture that follows it, fa, mi, re, do, si, do, re, fa, do, mi, si. To A major. And then we arrive at the second theme, which is quite childlike. We hear it in the cello. It goes la, mi, mi, fa, la, si, do, si. Thank you. And so as you see, this whole movement comes out of this "it must be" gesture and this descending fourth. And when we get to the development section, everything is either the theme itself or that canonic gesture based on the theme itself, or the second theme based on the theme itself. And toward the end of the piece, he returns to that introductory tense interrogatory section, and then he just blows it all away. And in the last moments of the piece, he gives us this very childlike second theme again, pizzicato, and it seems to wander off into the distance, getting further and further, and then at the very most distant, he turns around and he shouts in our face, "It must be." That's the end of his full string quartets, but there was one more movement that he owed his publisher. You may remember when we were talking about the B-flat major quartet, Opus 130, he had completed it with the Grosse Fuge, and his publisher had rejected that. He said, "Publish it separately, it's not a good ending, we can't sell the quartet." And so he agreed to write another more accessible ending to the piece, and he waited until after he had composed this quartet, the F major at Gneixendorf, and then he composed that final movement. It's called the Rondo Finale. And it's a very lovely movement. It's nothing like the Grosse Fuge. He gave it to his publisher loved it, they all loved it, and it became the ending of choice for Opus 130. But of course, the question always hovers over that quartet, which is the right ending for it. Clearly, in Beethoven's own mind, his original architecture was supposed to culminate with the Grosse Fuge, which was this culmination of what I think I mentioned was the paradigm of classical dissolution. And so there's always this question. And of course, back in the 19th century, when nobody understood the Grosse Fuge, they ended it with this Rondo Finale. In the 20th century, with Schoenberg and Stravinsky and all of the others, it became more palatable in a sense. And so in our own time, we more often than not hear the piece performed with the fugal finale. And so this question is, it's just hanging in the air. And I was looking for an answer to it, and I came across a paragraph, I think a very even-handed and mature assessment by a wonderful writer named Lewis Lockwood, a great Beethoven scholar. I'll just read it to you. "With the Rondo Finale of Opus 130 and the Grand Fugue, Opus 133, the dualism is one of the alternatives. Beethoven was, in effect, giving the world two choices, not absolutely displacing one with the other. And that legacy has not been lost on performers, many of whom now, in Beethoven cycles, play the whole work twice, once with each finale. In effect, they are being true to the spirit with which Beethoven in his last months came to a complex vision of this great work." And so with that evasive, or if you prefer, wisely all-encompassing view, I have reached the end of my own conversation about these 16 Beethoven string quartets and the Rondo Finale. And I would like to say thank you all for coming, and it has been a great pleasure to be here at CMS again, and I look forward to seeing you all again sometime soon.